Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Calvary Lemon Grove.
Thank you.
Let's bow our heads together. Father, we come before you this morning with thanksgiving, Lord, that you provided this time and place that we can gather together freely. Open your word. Pray that you would bless each of us today. Give us ears to hear and eyes to see what you have for us, Lord. We love you and give this time to you now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You'll join us in standing. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Draws me in. music sing her melody over me. God, right here, all I bring is all of me. Your kindness is what pulls me up. Your love is all that draws me in. I will lift my eyes to the Maker of the mountains I can't climb. I will lift my eyes to the Calmer of the ocean's raging wild. I will lift my
thank you. Salvation.
His promises to us. God bless. Say hi to someone.
It's a great day. I'm really looking forward to our study today because we're going to start in the Gospel of John today. And it's just, it's been a blast preparing the study, let's put it that way. Now Michael is going to come forward and he's going to lead us, or read us Psalm 143.
Psalm 143. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Give ear to my supplications. In your faithfulness, answer me. And in your righteousness, do not enter into judgment with your servant. For in your sight, no one living is righteous. For the enemy has persecuted my soul. He has crushed my life to the ground. He has made me dwell in darkness, like those who have long been dead. Therefore, my spirit is overwhelmed within me. My heart within me is distressed. I remember the days of old. I meditate on all your works. I muse on the work of your hands. I spread out my hands to you. My soul longs for you, like a thirsty land. Answer me speedily, O Lord, my spirit fails. Do not hide your face from me, lest I be like those who go down into the pit. Cause me to hear your loving kindness in the morning, for in you do I trust. Cause me to know the way in which I should walk, for I lift up my soul to you. Deliver me, O Lord, from my enemies. In you I take shelter. Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Your spirit is good. Lead me in the land of uprightness. Revive me, O Lord, for your name's sake. For your righteousness' sake, bring my soul out of trouble. In your mercy, cut off my enemies, and destroy all those who afflict my soul, for I am your servant.
Very good. Thank you, Michael. We don't plan these things, but that's just a perfect setup for our study of John's gospel, because you know the Messiah would eventually, of course, come from David's line, and here David's cry is for deliverance from his enemies. And, you know, reminders of God's righteousness and his tender mercies. And so God answered David's prayer. And he answered the cry of our hearts when he sent his son to this place where we have forgotten him, where we have turned our backs on him, where we have done so much to disappoint him. He's our deliverance, and you're going to see that as we go through John's gospel. It's going to be just a great study. I'm really excited about it. And now, for those of you who wish to support the Lord's work with your tithes and offerings, we're going to play one more song. And as we do, if you'd like to take advantage of the Agape box in the hallway, you can drop your offering in there. If you're visiting for the first time, please don't feel any pressure to give. We would rather have you just take in and receive what God has for you this morning. So enjoy the service. God bless you.
Is not of you.
heard today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Today, we're going to be in the Gospel of John. And it's just, I've been waiting so long to get to this day. It's just a glorious day. This is perhaps the most impactful book in the whole Bible. And so it's got the potential to transform and change your life. You may have read it many, many times. You may be very familiar with what it says, some of the verses we all have committed to memory. But that's the amazing thing about God's Word. I have found that no matter how many times I read a passage of Scripture, every time I read a passage of Scripture, something new comes forth. So God brings new insights, new ideas forth. And so the riches of God's Word are just inexhaustible. So even if it's ground that you've covered many times before, God has something new for you that He wants you to see, maybe that you've never noticed before. Today we're going to start with chapter 1, but we're not going to get through the whole chapter. So today we're going to read John chapter 1, verses 1 through 13. There's just too much there to speed through this. So, we're just going to take our time. And we're just going to enjoy what God has for us. We don't want to miss anything, right? And so as we begin this journey through the Gospel of John, just I hope you have a sense of anticipation, because it's really going to be a wonderful journey. Now, you know that Matthew, Mark, and Luke have been referred to as the Synoptic Gospels. Have you ever heard that phrase before?
Yeah.
Okay. Why are they called the Synoptic Gospels? Because they offer us the same general view of Christ's life. And they really present similar views of His life and His teachings. Jesus took 3 years to explain to the people of Israel, to the Jew, to those with a religious mindset, that their condition was desperate and their situation was hopeless. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are not so much a presentation of rules for us to live by. They're really more of a portrait of a Redeemer who came to rescue. The gospel before us has a little bit of a different purpose. You see, when John wrote his gospel, as we've discussed before, heresy was already present in the church. It doesn't take long, does it? We've talked about the Gnostics before. They maintained that the body is evil and that only the spirit is good. So they insisted that if Jesus was really God, He couldn't have had a body. They believed that when Jesus walked, He didn't leave any footprints. When He ate, He didn't really swallow His food. They suggested that while He appeared as a person, He didn't actually have a physical body. So how did John respond? Well, he said, "We've heard Him with our ears. We've seen Him with our eyes. We've touched Him with our hands." John said Jesus had a body. He is God, and He became man. Very important that we believe that. And you're going to see that from the very first verse of this precious gospel. And toward the end of the book, John tells us why he wrote it. "These are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in His name." That's from chapter 20, verse 31. Over the course of his life, John went through a remarkable transformation. We've referred to him before as the Apostle of Love, because more than anyone else in Scripture, John preaches and personifies love. You can see it even in his initial calling, where the Scripture says, "And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Then He said to them, 'Follow Me, and I will make you fishers of men.' They immediately left their nets and they followed Him." Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets, and he called them. That's from Matthew chapter 4. It's interesting that when Jesus called Peter, Peter was casting his net. I find that very appropriate, for he would go on to become a great evangelist who brought lots of people into the kingdom. 3,000 people got saved the first time he preached. John wasn't casting his net when Jesus called him. He was mending his net. This too is appropriate, because his ministry would seem to be one of restoring relationships and knitting people together in love. That's what John was all about. Now listen to his heart. He wrote, "Again, a new commandment I write to you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. He who says he is in the light and hates his brother is in darkness until now. He who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him." That's from 1 John chapter 2. Shortly thereafter, he wrote, "We know that we have passed from death to life because we love the brethren. He who does not love his brother abides in death." That's from 1 John chapter 3. This was the message of the man who was mending the nets, the one who tried to keep believers from fragmenting and splitting. His message was love, but we need to remember that John did not speak from some lofty theological perch, far removed from real life. Every one of Jesus' disciples, the original disciples, they died violent, brutal deaths, except for John. And it wasn't for lack of trying, and we talked about that before. Domitian, the Roman emperor, had John put into a cauldron of boiling oil, and when that failed to kill him, John was exiled to a rocky and seemingly God-forsaken island called Patmos, and that's where he received the book of Revelation. Now, eventually, John was released from his exile on Patmos, and he was probably nearing 100 years old when he returned to Asia Minor, and he went from church to church. Sometimes he was carried on a stretcher. And the historian Eusebius tells us that when John would enter these meeting places, people would break into applause for this one who knew Jesus, this one who had leaned on his breast. They would say, "Give us the word, John. Tell us something heavy." But John would deliver only a single sentence sermon: "Little children, love one another." That's the message that John carried from church to church. Little children, love one another. An elder asked, "Why don't you share something a little more weighty, a little more meaningful?" Eusebius says that John looked the elder in the eye and said, "The sole commandment of Christ is to love, for he that loves has no need of anything else." And that is very free. You see, we spend a lot of time figuring things out, analyzing situations, but that's really God's business. Our calling is to love our brothers and sisters, every one of them, any one of them. John knew this. He taught it. He exemplified it. Here's the interesting thing. The apostle of love, the one who penned the gospel that's been called a love letter to the world, was not always this way, was he? On the contrary, John was initially a walking powder keg. Jesus called him a son of thunder in Mark chapter 3. You want to see old Stormy in action? Look no further than Luke chapter 9. It says, "Now John answered and said, 'Master, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we forbade him because he does not follow with us.' But Jesus said to him, 'Do not forbid him, for he who is not against us is on our side.'" John was upset because someone outside the circle of disciples was using Jesus' name to see people released from demons. He said, "We told the guy to stop because he's not part of our denomination, you see. He doesn't share our doctrinal understandings. He's not one of us." And we can do this too. People can be saved, blessed, helped, and strengthened. But because we might have our doctrinal differences, we sometimes might have a tendency to put them down. We find fault because they might worship a little differently than we do. And that's not the way of love. You'd think that this son of thunder would have learned his lesson, but the text tells us differently. Now it came to pass, when the time had come for him to be received up, that he, meaning Jesus, steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem, and sent messengers before his face. And as they went, they entered a village of the Samaritans to prepare for him. But they did not receive him because his face was set for the journey to Jerusalem. And when his disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, just as Elijah did?" But he turned and rebuked them. And he said, "You do not know what manner of spirit you are of, for the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them." That's from Luke chapter 9. John was saying, "Come on, Lord, let's cast down fire. Let's blow these guys away. Let's burn them up." And Jesus answered, "Oh, John, don't you understand? I didn't come to hurt. I came to heal. I didn't come to fry people. I came to bless them. You and I need to hear the word of our Lord. He's not out to find fault or to put down or to critique. He came to save." John heard his word, and yet he continued to exhibit those thunderous tendencies. Check this out. Now Jesus, going up to Jerusalem, took the 12 disciples aside on the road and said to them, "Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and to the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify. And the third day he will rise again." Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to him with her sons, that would be James and John, kneeling down and asking something from him. And he said to her, "What do you wish?" And she said to him, "Grant that these two sons of mine may sit, one on your right hand and the other on the left, in your kingdom." That's from Matthew chapter 20. Can you believe that? I think the Hebrew word for that is chutzpah. James and John's mom was a good Jewish mom. But Jesus had just finished telling his disciples that he was about to be crucified, and John was worried about where he would be sitting in the kingdom. No wonder Jesus referred to John as stormy. See, that was his nature, finding fault with other ministers, wanting to call down fire from heaven on unbelievers, concerned about seating arrangements, his own position in the kingdom. With all of his faults, John did possess one sterling quality. Thousands came to see Jesus heal lepers, open blind eyes, and raise the dead. But only hundreds came to hear him teach. And of the hundreds who heard him teach, only 70 would actually follow him, as Luke chapter 10 tells us. Of the 70 who followed him, only 12 left everything. Of the 12 who left everything, only 3 went with him to the Mount of Transfiguration and prayed with him in Gethsemane. And of these 3, only 1 was at the cross. John lacked love, but he had loyalty. Maybe that's why Jesus looked down from the cross at this loyal one and commanded his mother into John's care, as John chapter 19 tells us. When did John become the apostle of love? When did he get transformed into the apostle of love? I believe it was at the cross. That's when John finally realized how much Jesus loved him. Perhaps that's the reason why throughout this gospel, John refers to himself not as the disciple who loved Jesus, but as the disciple whom Jesus loved. John knew he was a son of thunder, so it was no surprise that he loved Jesus. Who wouldn't love the one who was so gracious and so merciful, so powerful and so kind? It was no surprise that John loved Jesus. The surprise was that Jesus loved John. That's why we'll spend time in John's gospel just looking at Jesus. Like John, as we gaze at Jesus, we too will slowly change from thunder to love. As we study this book together, we want to keep in mind three unique characteristics that are inherent in John's gospel. The first of these is authenticity. The Apostle John knew Jesus long before he became Jesus' follower. You see, John's mother was a woman named Salome. Most Bible scholars agree that Salome was the sister of Mary, Jesus' mother. That would make Jesus and John cousins. And like other Jewish families of that day, John and Jesus probably spent lots of time together at family celebrations, reunions, that sort of thing. Above all, they probably traveled together to Jerusalem to celebrate feast days. Most likely they talked, they laughed, they played games together on the long trips from Galilee to Jerusalem. But one day, John became convinced that this cousin of his, this boyhood pal, this companion, was in fact God. And that gives great authenticity to his gospel. After all, how many of us would leave everything behind to follow our cousin? And who among us would say, as John does in the first book of, verse of this book, my cousin is God? The second characteristic to keep in mind is selectivity. When we get to the end of this book, we'll find that John closes his gospel by telling us that the world wouldn't be able to contain the books that could have been written about Jesus' life and works. Because of this, John was very selective in that which he chose to record. He based his entire account on only 8 signs or miracles. He did not record any boyhood incidents. Jesus' baptism isn't mentioned. He doesn't give us an account of Jesus' temptation or of his agony at Gethsemane. There are no tax collectors, no demon-possessed people. John chose not to write about much of what the synoptic writers, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, spent a great deal of time recording. Instead, John wrote about the 8 signs that Jesus used to illustrate his great ego eimi, or I am, statements. The book of Exodus tells us that Moses asked God, what is your name? People are going to ask me, Lord, what is your name? How do I tell them? How do I answer them? What do I say to them? You remember how the Lord answered? He said, I am that I am. Now I can picture Moses scratching his head and thinking, you are what? Jesus came on the scene and echoed that same declaration of deity. In John's gospel, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. I am the good shepherd. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the resurrection. I am the vine. I am the door. In effect, Jesus filled in that blank that his father left when God had declared his name to be I am. The third characteristic that we're going to see is practicality. You remember that John tells us why he wrote this gospel in chapter 20, verse 31. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. When someone says they don't know if they believe that Jesus is really God, I can say, invest 2 hours of your life in reading through John's gospel from start to finish. Ask the Lord to show you whether he's real. And believe me, he will. Because this book was written so that people might believe that Jesus is God, I believe it's the most powerful tract that you can share with anyone. You might want to stock up on copies of John's gospel. Share with people who are skeptical, questioning. This verse also contains the second reason why John wrote this gospel, that believing you may have life in his name. He wrote it for those of us who already believe. The Greek word that's translated as believing speaks of a continual action. John tells us that the more we believe, the more life we will experience. Thus, John wrote to convince the skeptic, but also to provoke the believer toward a continual growing belief in the Savior. Jesus said, by your love shall all know that you are my disciples, in John chapter 13. And as we study this gospel of love, it is my prayer that we, like its author, will be transformed and changed from glory to greater glory as we fall in love with Jesus all over again. John chapter 1, verse 1 begins, in the beginning. Let's stop right there for a minute. This refers to the timeless eternity of Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. It doesn't say at the beginning. It doesn't say from the beginning. It says in the beginning. For you see, Jesus was already there. Verse 1 continues. Was the Word. The Greek term translated as word is logos. The idea had deep, rich roots in Jewish and Greek thinking. Jewish rabbis often referred to God in terms of his word. They spoke of God himself as the Word of God. For example, ancient Hebrew editions of the Old Testament change Exodus 19, verse 17 a little bit. In our Bible, it says Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet with God. And they changed that to Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet the Word of God. In the mind of ancient Jews, the phrase Word of God could be used to refer to God himself. Greek philosophers saw logos as the power that puts sense into the world, making the world orderly instead of chaotic. Logos was the power that set the world in perfect order and kept it going in perfect order. They saw the logos as the ultimate reason that controlled all things. Therefore, in his opening, John said to both Jews and to Greeks, for centuries you've been talking, thinking, and writing about the Word, the Logos. Now I'm going to tell you who he is. John met both Jews and Greeks where they were at and explained Jesus in terms that they already understood. Verse 1 continues, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus, the Word, was with God, equal to the Father and the Spirit. Wait a minute, you say. I thought there was only one God. That's right. There is only one God. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 declares, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. But the word one is echad. And this refers to a compound unity. Like a one people or one cluster of grapes. Thus, God is a compound unity, or a triunity. One plus one plus one does not equal one, does it? But one times one does equal one. So John chapter 1, verse 1 establishes one of our faith's basic foundations, the Trinity. In his very essence, Jesus is God. The Gnostics denied this, and their heresy is alive and well today. For you see, every cult stems from Gnosticism. For every cult denies that Jesus Christ is God. The Mormons deny it. They say the Son of God is not equal with God. They maintain that Jesus is merely God's offspring. The Jehovah's Witnesses declare that Jesus is a God. One letter, one little article that they add in changes the whole context and the meaning of that verse. The Way International has decided that although Jesus is the Son of God, he is not equal to God. To them, Jesus is the Son of God, not God the Son. They do not believe that Jesus is omniscient, omnipresent, or omnipotent. So what do you say to these present-day Gnostics? Turn them to Revelation chapter 21, verse 6. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give of the fountain of the water of life freely to him who thirsts. Now ask a Mormon or a Jehovah's Witness, who is the one who gives of the water of the fountain of life? Who is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end? And they'll say, it's God. Very good. Then have them turn the page to Revelation chapter 22, verse 12. And behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me, to give to everyone according to his work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Ask them who is going to return. they'll reply, Jesus. But now they'll have a problem. Because if they say that Jesus is not God, then they'll have two alphas and two omegas, two firsts and two lasts. The only logical conclusion is that Jesus Christ is in fact God. The doctrine of Jesus' deity is essential, and it is non-negotiable. If you say that Jesus is simply a created extension of God, you open the door to every other heresy. And even more importantly, if you deny that Jesus is God, you minimize the work that God did on your behalf when he became a man and paid the price for your sin. Verse 2, he was in the beginning with God. Contrary to most cults' teaching, Jesus was not the first created being. He was already present in the beginning. He has always existed. Verse 3, all things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. The Word created all things that were created. Therefore, he himself is an uncreated being. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, we see that God created all things. In this verse, we see that Christ created all things. Therefore, Christ and the Father are one. Think about it. Everything was made by Jesus Christ. Even this day was made by Jesus Christ. To give you an idea how big the universe is and how small we are, I'm going to take you back to your school science class. Maybe you studied some of these things, I don't know. To give you an idea just how big the universe is, think about our sun. Our sun is big. It's so big that 1.3 million of our Earths could fit inside of it. Wow. That sounds big, doesn't it? But it's really pretty small when you compare it to Antares, a star in our galaxy. It's estimated that 700 of our suns could fit inside Antares. But Antares is a relatively dinky star. You could fit 110 million Antares inside of Hercules. So 110 million Antares, each of which is big enough to hold 700 of our suns, which are each big enough to hold 1.3 million Earths, could fit into Hercules. When we realize this, it is clear that we are nothing more than specks on a speck in a speck. Even so, most of the time we think we're pretty spectacular. Now, put down your telescope for a minute, pick up your microscope, and consider a drop of water, which is equally amazing. Think back to that science class in school again. You'll remember that each water molecule is composed of two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom, right? Now, if you can enlarge each atom in a single drop of water to be the size of a grain of sand, you'd have enough sand to make a concrete slab, 1 foot thick, half mile high, stretching all the way from San Francisco to New York City. It's a lot of sand. Now in Colossians chapter 1, verse 16, Paul tells us that all things were created by Jesus. We've discussed this before. Scientists call the atomic force that holds the atom's nucleus together, atomic glue. The Bible identifies this mysterious atomic glue as Jesus Christ. For by him, all things consist or hold together, as Colossians chapter 1 tells us. The day is coming when Jesus will let go of his hold on the atom, and the result will be chaos and utter devastation. You can read about that in 2 Peter chapter 3. However, in this day of grace, Jesus continues to hold the galaxies, the atoms, and our lives together. Why do you exist today? You were made by him. You were made for him. If you don't give your life to him, like errant atoms, you'll fall apart. Life won't make sense. You'll wonder what you're doing, where you're going, why you're living. The secret of life is found right here in John's prologue. All things were made by him. John chapter 1, verse 4. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. The Word is the source of all life, not only biological life, but the very principle of life. This life is the light of men, speaking of spiritual light, The Word doesn't just contain life and light. He is life and light. Therefore, without Jesus, we are dead and in darkness. We're lost. It's interesting that people have an innate fear of both death and darkness. The Greek word that's translated comprehend is katalambano. It can mean either to extinguish or to understand. Both meanings are applicable here, for the darkness could neither understand nor extinguish Jesus. For 3 hours, the earth was darkened when it seemed as though the light of the world had been extinguished. But 3 days later, he was back to shine in our hearts as the bright and morning star, the day spring from on high. John chapter 1, verse 6, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. So John the Apostle introduces us to John the Baptist. As a prophet, John the Baptist spoke to people on behalf of God. As a priest, as Luke chapter 1 describes him, he spoke to God on behalf of people. And that's what ministry is all about. It's both prophetic and priestly. It's talking to people about God and talking about God to people. Verse 7, this man came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all through him might believe. John the Baptist's work was deliberately focused on bringing people to faith in Jesus as the Messiah. Notice that John was a witness, and that is what we're called to be. We're not called to be attorneys. We're not called to debate or to argue or to convince. We're called to be witnesses, to share the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth concerning what the Lord is doing in our lives. You'll find great freedom in simply sharing with people what the Lord is showing you. You won't feel any pressure to convert or to convince anyone. You'll find great pleasure in sharing what the Lord has done, is doing, and will continue to do in your life. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9 tells us that God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So the desire of God's heart is that not one person should die without knowing him. Think of the person who bugs and irritates you the most. Did you know that our Lord is madly in love with him or her and desires that he or she should be saved? Personally, I reject the ultra-Calvinistic teaching that says that God has already determined that some are born to be damned. The scripture says that John was sent for a witness, that all through him might believe. The Greek word for all is the word pas. You know what it means? It means all, each, every, any, all, the whole enchilada, everyone, all things, everything. All means all, period. John chapter 1, verse 8. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. So at the time John wrote his gospel, around AD 75 or so, people were already beginning to worship John the Baptist. The same type of thing happens today with the Baha'i mentality that teaches that there are many men of equal greatness. Jesus is good, it says. So are John the Baptist, Moses, Buddha, Muhammad. So the Apostle John was trying to do a Barney Fife here. He's trying to nip this idea, nip it in the bud. Here at the very outset of his gospel, the Apostle John makes it crystal clear that John the Baptist was not Jesus' equal. Now it's important to note that John the Baptist himself never claimed to be the Christ. He never tried to usurp Jesus' position. We'll hear more about that later in this chapter when we get to it. But let's turn to verse 9 now. That was the true light which gives light to every man who comes into the world. So at the end of time, nobody is ever going to be able to say that they never had the opportunity to know that there is a God. The light has come, and it lights every person who comes into the world. Romans chapter 1 tells us that the creation surrounding us is a testimony to God's reality, and that our conscience within us verifies this truth. Psalm 19 states that the heavens declare the glory of God, and there is no place on earth where their voice is not heard. Thus, whether a person looks up at the sky or at the creation all around us or within their own heart, they're left without excuse regarding the existence of their Creator. Every person innately, intuitively knows that there is a God, even the pygmies in Africa. I firmly believe that if there's someone in even the most remote corner of the world, hungering and thirsting after a saving knowledge of God, God will do whatever it takes to contact that one. He may choose to speak to them through an angel, or perhaps through a miracle, or maybe even you. If you're concerned about lost people and God's ability to reach them, don't stay here and discuss the ramifications of predestination. Go tell them that Jesus died for them. You may be the very messenger that God uses to reach someone who's waiting to hear the gospel. Verse 10, he was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. Think about it. Jesus, the light, the true light, came to shine in the darkness. We've already been told that all things were made by him, and without him nothing was made that was made. He was in the world, he made the world, yet the world did not know him. That is, the world of man did not know him. It appears that there were aspects of nature and of the world that did know him. Those who are possessed by evil spirits often cried out, "We know who you are." Evidently, the wind and the waves knew who he was. Remember, he was standing in the little ship, and it was about to sink, and he spoke to the wind and the waves. He told them, "Peace, be still." They obeyed his voice. They knew who he was. It seems that the rocks also knew who he was, because when the Pharisees encouraged him to rebuke his disciples on the day of his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, he said, "I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out." They knew who he was. Only the darkened mind of man failed to recognize him. He was in the world, he made the world, and yet the world did not know him. What a sad, tragic statement that is. Verse 11, he came to his own, and his own did not receive him. So Jesus came into this world, and all of creation acknowledged him. The winds obeyed him, the water supported him. The rocks were ready to cry out to him. But there was one segment of creation that did not receive him. Humanity, man. Human nature is the only part of nature that refuses to worship God. And oh, we are certainly capable of worship, aren't we? When the Trojans yet again beat up the Fighting Irish in football, people in the stands will go crazy. They lift their hands in the air victoriously. They high-five people they've never met before. They clap exuberantly. They cheer wildly. They stand, they yell, they stomp their feet. They won't care who sees them. The same thing happens at rock concerts, hockey games, beauty pageants, rodeos. Humanity creatively and radically worships with abandon. But when it comes to worshiping Jesus, arms fold, voices hush, and sitting becomes the position of choice. Our culture finds it very easy to worship sports, movie, or rock stars, but it has great difficulty worshiping Jesus or acknowledging the great things that he has done for us. Verse 12 begins, "But." Thank God for the word "but." Many great truths swing on this small hinge. "As many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name." The angel said to Mary, "You shall call his name Jesus." The name Jesus means Jehovah is salvation. You will receive the right, the power, to become a child of God when you believe that Jesus is not merely a Savior or even the Savior, but that he is your Savior. Verse 13, "Who were born not of blood." Okay, your grandfather might have been an awesome Christian. You might have 14 preachers in your family tree, But according to this verse, these things don't make a bit of difference, because birth in God's family is not transmitted genetically. It has nothing to do with blood, which speaks of descent. Verse 13 continues, nor of the will of the flesh. So birth into God's family doesn't have anything to do with desire either. Paul tells us there is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. No one who really desires him. Romans chapter 3. Verse 13 continues, nor of the will of man. Birth into God's family doesn't have anything to do with determination either. Man can't will himself into a relationship with God. Verse 13 concludes, but of God. God does it all. It is his sovereign work in the hearts of people that draws them to himself. Wait a minute, you say. Doesn't 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9 tell us that his desire is that not one should perish? Why doesn't he do his sovereign work in the heart of every person and draw everyone to himself? I don't know. I do know that we serve an enormous God. He's given every one of us the opportunity to choose him. And yet he has retained his right to choose whom he will. How can these two principles be compatible? I don't know. I do know that according to Romans chapter 8, verse 29, God's foreknowledge is a big factor. But did God choose us because he knew we'd choose him? Or did we choose God because he had already chosen us? I don't know. I do know that if you think about this very long, your brain will short circuit. You'll get very frustrated, and you will likely end up concurring with J.B. Phillips, who said, if God was small enough to figure out, he wouldn't be big enough to worship. Then you'll fall on your face and worship him, saying, Lord, I don't understand it all, but I thank you for choosing me. Next time, we're going to pick up with John chapter 1, verse 14. You're going to love it. It's really good news. Father, we just love you and thank you so much for providing us this record of your Son, who is co-equal with you, who is, in fact, God. And as we'll see next week, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Of his mercy we have all received, and grace for grace. Oh, how wonderful you are, Lord. How complete is your provision. We can add nothing to it. All we have to do is accept it and proclaim it. And that's what we do. We do not proclaim what we do, Lord. We proclaim what you have done. That is our message. You are our heart's cry. You are the answer to every prayer we've ever prayed. And we love you, and we thank you, and we worship you now. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you'll stand with us, please.
All that I need.
Children, love one another. The Lord bless thee.
The Lord bless thee.
And keep thee.
And keep thee.
The Lord make his face to shine upon thee. And be gracious unto thee. And be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up.
The Lord lift up.
His countenance.
His countenance.
Upon thee and give thee peace. God richly bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.